Good morning, friends. Today, Mangalore University joins the nation in celebrating the 68th Republic Day. And to make that possible in a meaningful way, we have a very special person in our chief guest, Colonel M.C. Ayyappa. May I now request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor K. Bhairappa, and our chief guest, Colonel M.C. Ayyappa, to kindly come over to the dais. May I request our registrar and our registrar evaluation, Dr. K.M. Lokesh and Dr. A.M. Khan, to kindly accompany the president of this program, Professor K. Bhairappa, and our chief guest, Colonel M.C. Ayyappa, onto the dais. Friends, we are here. It is a moment of pride for all of us and to symbolize that moment of pride, but also a moment in which we commit ourselves to the nation. We have a beautiful song, an immortal song, the immortal song composed, written for us, given to us as an immortal legacy by Rashtrakavi Kuvempu. This song, the Nadagite, the state anthem of Karnataka, will now be sung by the students of the BPED and MPED program of Mangalore University. May I request everyone to rise for the state anthem, the immortal song by Rashtrakavi Kuvempu.
Jai Bharat Janani Ananu Jati, Jai Karnataka Mati, Jai Sundara Nadi Anagala Tate, Jai Sakshi Ganani, Bhuti Niya Bhakunara Navani.
Karnataka is an integral part of the nation, and so are we, ladies and gentlemen. So is Mangalore University. And to welcome everyone here, may I now request our registrar, Professor K.M. Lokesh, to welcome the gathering.
Namaskar. Aarambhadalli nimagellarigu 68ne ganarajyotsavada shubhashayagalannu harisutene. ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾನಿಲಯದ ಕುಲಪತಿಗಳಾಗಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಕೆ ಭೈರಪ್ಪನವರೇ, ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಈ ಗಣರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವ ಆಚರಣೆಗೆ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಗಳಾಗಿ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಕರ್ನಲ್ ಎಂ ಸಿ ಅಯ್ಯಪ್ಪನವರೇ, ಕುಲ ಸಚಿವರಾಗಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾಂಗ ವಿಭಾಗದ್ದು ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಕೆ ಖಾನ್ ಅವರೇ, ಇಲ್ಲಿಗೆ ಆಗಮಿಸಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ನನ್ನ ಮಿತ್ರರೇ, ಇವತ್ತು ಬಹಳ ಸಂತೋಷದ ದಿನ ನಮಗೆ. ಭಾರತ ದೇಶ ಒಂದು ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಆಗಿ, ಒಂದು ಗಣರಾಜ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಸುಮಾರು 68 ವರ್ಷಗಳಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ದಿನ ಇದು. 1947 ಇಸವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯ ಪಡೆದು 1950 ಇಸವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಗಣರಾಜ್ಯವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಭಾರತ ಸುಮಾರು 68 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಕಾಲ ತನ್ನ ಒಂದು ಗಣರಾಜ್ಯ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದರ ಸ್ವರೂಪವನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ನಮಗೆಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಹೆಮ್ಮೆ ಆಗಬೇಕು. ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ವಿಟ್ನೆಸ್ಡ್ ವಾಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಅವರ್ ನೇಬರಿಂಗ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಅವರ್ ನೇಬರಿಂಗ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೀಸ್. ಪಾಕಿಸ್ತಾನ 1952 ಇಸವಿಯಿಂದಲೇ ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ರೂಲಿಗೆ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡ್ತು. ಬಾಂಗ್ಲಾದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವಾರು ಬಾರಿ ಸೈನಿಕ ಆಡಳಿತ ಬಂತು. ಚೈನಾದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆಡಳಿತ ಇದೆ. ಮಿಡ್ಲ್ ಈಸ್ಟ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವಾರು ಕಡೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ರಾಜಮನೆತನವೋ ಅಥವಾ ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ರೂಲೋ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಸೊ ಆಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆಸ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಈಸ್ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್, ವಿ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ಪ್ರೌಡ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಏಬಲ್ ಟು ಮೈಂಟೈನ್ ಅವರ್ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕನ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಇನ್ ಸ್ಪೈಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ದಟ್ ದೇರ್ ವರ್ ಸೆವರಲ್ ಚಾಲೆಂಜಸ್ ಟು ಇಟ್ಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಏನು, ಹೇಗಾಯಿತು, ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನಾನು ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಭಾರತ ವಸಾಹತುಶಾಹಿ ಆಡಳಿತದೊಳಗೆ ಬಂದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭ. ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಆ ವಸಾಹತುಶಾಹಿ ಆಡಳಿತದ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲ್ ಅಂತ ಏನು ಕರಿತೇವೆ ಅದರ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಹೋರಾಡ್ತಾ ಬಂದ್ವಿ. ಆ ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟದ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ರೂಪುಗೊಂಡಂಥ ಒಂದು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅದೊಂದು ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರಾಟಿಕ್ ಆಗಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು. ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯ ಸಂಗ್ರಾಮ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದು ಯಾವಾಗ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಆಯಿತು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಸಂಗೊಳ್ಳಿ ರಾಯಣ್ಣ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಫ್ರೀಡಮ್ ಫೈಟರ್, ಟಿಪ್ಪು ಸುಲ್ತಾನ್ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಫ್ರೀಡಮ್ ಫೈಟರ್, ಕಿತ್ತೂರು ಚೆನ್ನಮ್ಮ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಫ್ರೀಡಮ್ ಫೈಟರ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇನ್ 1857 ವಿ ಫಾಟ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ದ ಬ್ರಿಟಿಷ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ಡೆಸ್ಟ್ರಾಯ್ ದಿ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಬಟ್ ವಿ ಡಿಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸಕ್ಸೀಡ್. ಬಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ವೇ ವಿ ಯುನೋ ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂ ಟು ಫೈಟ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ದಿ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲ್ ಫಾರ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಟೈಮ್. ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲ್ನ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಫೈಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳು, ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳು ರೂಪುಗೊಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಆ ಒಂದು ರೂಪುಗೊಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಹಲವಾರು ಭಾರತೀಯ ನಾಯಕರು ಹುಟ್ಟಿಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಅದು ನಿಮಗೆ ಸರ್ದಾರ್ ಪಟೇಲ್ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ನೆಹರು ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಮೋತಿಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಬದ್ರುದ್ದೀನ್ ತ್ಯಾಬ್ಜಿ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಉಮೇಶ್ ಚಂದ್ರ ಬ್ಯಾನರ್ಜಿ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಲೋಕಮಾನ್ಯ ತಿಲಕರಾಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಗೋಪಾಲಕೃಷ್ಣ ಗೋಖಲೆ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅಂತಿಮವಾಗಿ ಗಾಂಧೀಜಿಯವರಾಗಿರ್ಬೋದು. ನಮ್ಮ ಹೋರಾಟದ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದು ಒಂದು ರೀತಿಯ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಟಿಕ್ ಆದಂಥ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಆಗಿತ್ತು. ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಎನಿ ರಿಲಿಜಿಯಸ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ, ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಆ್ಯಂಟಿ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ಭಾರತ ದೇಶದವರೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಒಂದೇ, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲಿನ ವಸಾಹತುಶಾಹಿ ಆಡಳಿತದ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಣಾಮಕ್ಕೆ ಒಳಗಾಗಿ ಸಫರ್ ಆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ರೂಲಿನ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ನಾವು ಹೋರಾಡಬೇಕು, ಹೋರಾಡಿ ಅದನ್ನು ಡೆಸ್ಟ್ರಾಯ್ ಮಾಡಿ ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದಂಥ ಒಂದು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯನ್ನು ಸೃಷ್ಟಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಉದ್ದೇಶದಿಂದ ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟವನ್ನು ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಅದು ಸಂಘಟಿತವಾದಂಥ ಹೋರಾಟವಾಗಿ 1885 ಇಸವಿಯಿಂದ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ವೆನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಕಾಂಗ್ರೆಸ್ ವಾಸ್ ಫೌಂಡೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಇಯರ್ 1885 ಯುನೋ ಅಟ್ ಬಾಂಬೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಆದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟ ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ. ಬಹಳ ದೀರ್ಘವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟ, ಮಹಾತ್ಮ ಗಾಂಧಿಯವರ ನೇತೃತ್ವಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದ ನಂತರ ಅದು ಒಂದು ಅಹಿಂಸಾತ್ಮಕವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟವಾಗಿ, ಒಂದು ಬಹಳ ಏನು ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ ಬ್ರಾಡ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಏನಿದೆ, ಒಂದು ಜಾತ್ಯತೀತವಾದಂಥ ಧರ್ಮ ನಿರಪೇಕ್ಷಿತವಾದಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಲಿಬರ್ಟಿಯನ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿಯನ್ನು ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ಹೋರಾಟ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು. ಅದು ಒಂದು ಅಂಶ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ತಿಳ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯವನ್ನು ಬ್ರಿಟಿಷಿಂದ ಕೇಳಲಿಲ್ಲ 1929 ಇಸವಿವರೆಗೆ. ವಿ ವೆಂಟ್ ಆನ್ ಫೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ದಿ ಕಲೋನಿಯಲ್ ರೂಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ರಿಸೀವ್ ಸಮ್ ಪ್ಯಾಕೇಜಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲ್ ರಿಫಾರ್ಮ್ಸ್. ಬಟ್ ಇನ್ 1929 ಅಟ್ ದಿ ಲಾಹೋರ್ ಕಾಂಗ್ರೆಸ್, ಪಂಡಿತ್ ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ಯುನೋ ಅನೌನ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಅವರ್ ಬ್ಯಾಟಲ್ ಇಯರ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ವುಡ್ ಬಿ ಫಾರ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಇಂಡಿಪೆಂಡೆನ್ಸ್. ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದೆ ನಮ್ಮದು ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಇಂಡಿಪೆಂಡೆನ್ಸ್, ಪೂರ್ಣ ಸ್ವರಾಜ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. 1929 ಡಿಸೆಂಬರ್ ತಿಂಗಳ 30ನೇ ತಾರೀಕು ರಾವಿ ನದಿಯ ಮೇಲೆ ತ್ರಿವರ್ಣ ಧ್ವಜವನ್ನು ಹಾರಿಸ್ತಾ ಅವರು ಆ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅನ್ನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಏನು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ವಿ ಆರ್ ನಾವು ಎಂಟರಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಎ ನ್ಯೂ ಫೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅವರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಗಲ್ ಎಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ದ ಬ್ರಿಟಿಷರು. ಈಗ ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಲ್ಲುದು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಪೂರ್ಣ ಸ್ವರಾಜ್ ಪಡೆದಾಗ ಮಾತ್ರ ನಿಲ್ಲುವುದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಪ್ರತಿ ವರ್ಷ ಜನವರಿ 26ನೇ ತಾರೀಕಿನಂದು ನಾವು ತ್ರಿವರ್ಣ ಧ್ವಜವನ್ನು ಹಾರಿಸಬೇಕು ಮತ್ತು ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯದ ಒಂದು ದಿನಾಚರಣೆ ಆಚರಿಸಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಸೆಲೆಬ್ರೇಟೆಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಆನ್ 26 January 1930. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ 1947ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿವರೆಗೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಹೋರಾಟವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದ್ವಿ, ತ್ರಿವರ್ಣದವನ್ನು ಹಾರಿಸ್ತಾ ಹೋದ್ವಿ. ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಏನಾಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ವಿ ವಾಂಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಎಸ್ಟಾಬ್ಲಿಷ್ ಎ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಟಿಕ್ ನೇಷನ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಟಿಕ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಆರ್ ಪಾರ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟರಿ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಸಿ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. 1947ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮಗೆ ಸ್ವಾತಂತ್ರ್ಯ ಬಂದಾಗ ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದು ಇಷ್ಟೇ, ಲಾಂಗ್ ಯಸ್ ಎಗೋ ವಿ ಮೇಡ್ ಎ ಟ್ರಿಸ್ಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಡೆಸ್ಟಿನಿ, ಟುಡೇ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ವೆನ್ ವಿ ರಿಡೀಮ್ ಅವರ್ ಪ್ಲಡ್ಜ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ. ಸೊ 1930ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವೊಂದು ಪ್ಲಡ್ಜನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ, ಒಂದು ಪ್ರತಿಜ್ಞೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ 1947, ಇವತ್ತು ಅದನ್ನು ರೆಡಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ. ಪೂರ್ಣ ಸ್ವರಾಜ್ ನಮಗೆ ಬಂದಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು 1947ರಿಂದ 50ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿವರೆಗೆ ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಭಾರತದ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ರೂಪಿಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯವನ್ನು ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೈಗೆತ್ತಿಕೊಂಡಿವಿ. ದ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಂಟ್ ಅಸೆಂಬ್ಲಿ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟೆಡ್ ಎ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಡ್ರಾಫ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಕಮಿಟಿ ವಿತ್ ಬಿ ಆರ್ ಅಂಬೇಡ್ಕರ್ ಆಸ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಚೇರ್ಮನ್. ಸುಮಾರು 308 ಜನ ಹಗಲು ರಾತ್ರಿ ದುಡಿದ್ರು, ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಒಂದು ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟನ್ನು ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದರು. ಅದೇ ಸಂವಿಧಾನ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಕ್ಕ ಸಂವಿಧಾನ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುವಾಗ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಅದು ಒಂದು ದೇಶದ ಆತ್ಮ ಇದ್ದಾಗೆ, ಇಟ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ದ ಸೋಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಎ ನೇಷನ್. ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯ ಒಂದು ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ನ ನಮ್ಮ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಸಿ ಹೊಂದಿರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ, ವಿ ಡಿಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಎಸ್ಟಾಬ್ಲಿಷ್ ಎ ಥಿಯೋಕ್ರಾಟಿಕ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್, ವಾಟ್ಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ರಿಲಿಜನ್. ವಿ ವಾಂಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಎಸ್ಟಾಬ್ಲಿಷ್ ಎ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಟಿಕ್ ನೇಷನ್, ಎ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕನ್ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ವೇರ್ ದ ಹೆಡ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ವುಡ್ ಬಿ ದ ರೆಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಟಿವ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು. ಸೊ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಾವು ರೂಪಿಸಿದ್ವಿ 1947ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿ ನವೆಂಬರ್ ತಿಂಗಳ 4ನೇ ತಾರೀಕಿಗೆ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ರೆಡಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸುಮಾರು 2 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಕಾಲ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಚರ್ಚೆಗಳಾಗ್ತದೆ. ಸುಮಾರು 2 ವರ್ಷ 11 ತಿಂಗಳುಗಳ ಕಾಲ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. 2000 ಅಮೆಂಡ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಗಳಾಗ್ತದೆ. 1949ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿ ನವೆಂಬರ್ 26ಕ್ಕೆ ಅದು ಅಂತಿಮ ರೂಪವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದು 1950ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿ ಜನವರಿ 26ಕ್ಕೆ ಅದು ಜಾರಿಗೆ ಬರತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಸೊ ದ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಡೇಟ್ January 26 ಇಸ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಇನ್ 1930 ದಟ್ ವಿ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಡಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಟು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕನ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್. ಅದನ್ನು 1950ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಅದನ್ನು ರಿಯಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ 1950ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿ ಜನವರಿ 26ಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಮಗೆ ಕೊಟ್ಕೊಂಡ್ವಿ. ಸೊ ವಿ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟೆಡ್ ಅವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಎ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್, ಎ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಸೆಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಸಾವರಿನ್ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಟಿಕ್ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ. ಆರಂಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು 2 ಪದಗಳಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಸೆಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಮತ್ತು ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಅದು ಅನಂತರ ಸೇರಿಕೊಂಡಂಥದ್ದು. ಬಟ್ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದ ಒಂದು ಚರಿತ್ರೆ ನಾವು ನೋಡಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋದಾಗ ನಾವು ಕಾಣ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಏನಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ನಾವು ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ವಸಾಹತುಶಾಹಿಯ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಹೋರಾಟ ಮಾಡಿ, ವಿದೇಶಿಯರ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಹೋರಾಟ ಮಾಡಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಅಂತಸತ್ವವನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಈ ಒಂದು ಅಂತಸತ್ವ ಏನಿದೆ, ಇಟ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಮ್ಯಾನಿಫೆಸ್ಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಎ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆನ್ 26 January 1926. ಇವತ್ತಿಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು 68 ವರ್ಷಗಳಾದವು. ನಮ್ಮೊಟ್ಟಿಗೇ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಆದಂಥ ಪಾಕಿಸ್ತಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ಇವತ್ತೇನಾಗಿದೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಸಿರೀಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ರೂಲ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಹಲವಾರು ಕಡೆ ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಸಿಗಳು ನಾಶವಾಗೋಯಿತು, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ರೂಲ್ ಬಂತು, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಜಪ್ರಭುತ್ವ ಇನ್ನೂ ಕೂಡ ಉಳಿದಿದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಭಾರತದ ಒಂದು ಹಿರಿಮೆ ಏನು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಫಾರ್ ದ ಪಾಸ್ಟ್ 68 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಯುನೋ ಹೋಲ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಆನ್ ಟು ಅವರ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಯುನೋ ವೆರಿ ರಿಲಿಜಿಯಸ್ಲಿ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಯಾವುದೇ ಬೆದರಿಕೆ ಬಂದಾಗ ಅದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಪ್ರೊಟೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ, ಅದನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಪಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ. ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಇನ್ ದ ಇಯರ್ 1976 ವೆನ್ ಮಿಸಸ್ ಇಂದಿರಾ ಗಾಂಧಿ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಪ್ರೈಮ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಯುನೋ ಶಿ ಡಿಕ್ಲೇರ್ಡ್ ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ. ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಡೆಮೊಕ್ರೆಸಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಕಪ್ಪು ಚುಕ್ಕಿ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಕೆಲವು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ತಜ್ಞರು ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ ಪಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಏಕೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ವಾಸ್ ಸಸ್ಪೆಂಡೆಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್, ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ರೈಟ್ಸ್ ವರ್ ರಿಮೂವ್ಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಏನು ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ, ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ತುರ್ತು ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ನಾವು ಹೋರಾಟ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. 1977ನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ರೆಸ್ಟೋರ್ ಆಗ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡ್ತೇವೆ. ಸೊ ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದ ಒಂದು ನಮಗೊಂದು ಮಾರ್ಗದರ್ಶಿ ಸೂತ್ರ, ಅದು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಆಡಳಿತವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಅಷ್ಟು ಮಾತ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲ, ನಮ್ಮ ಭಾರತ ದೇಶದ ಭವ್ಯ ಪರಂಪರೆ ಏನಿದೆ ಆ ಪರಂಪರೆಯ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅಂಶಗಳನ್ನು ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಸೇರಿಸಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಪಂಚಶೀಲ ತತ್ವವನ್ನು ಸೇರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ಪ್ರಜಾಪ್ರಭುತ್ವವನ್ನು ಸೇರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ನಾಗರಿಕ ಹಕ್ಕುಗಳನ್ನು ಸೇರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ಈಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿಯನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ಲಿಬರ್ಟಿ ಈಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿ ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ನಾವು ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದು ಒಂದು ಹೆಮ್ಮೆಯವಾದ ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಇವತ್ತಿನಿಗೆ ಹಲವಾರು ಅಮೆಂಡ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಗಳು ಆಗಿದ್ರೂ ಕೂಡ, ತಿದ್ದುಪಡಿಗಳಾಗಿದ್ರೂ ಕೂಡ ಅದರ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಏನಿದೆ, ದ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿನ್ ಆಲ್ಟರ್ಡ್ ಸೋ ಫಾರ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ವೆರಿ ಪ್ರೌಡ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಲಿಬರಲ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಟು ಅಮೆರಿಕಾ. ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಮೋರ್ ಲಿಬರಲ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ತಜ್ಞರು ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ ಪಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡು, ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಂಡು ನಮ್ಮ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕನ್ನು ನಾವು ಕಾಪಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಬರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಫೇಸ್ಡ್ ಸೆವರಲ್ ಚಾಲೆಂಜಸ್, ಹಲವಾರು ಚಾಲೆಂಜ್ಗಳನ್ನ ಎದುರಿಸಬಹುದು. 1947 ಯುದ್ಧವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು ಪಾಕಿಸ್ತಾನದೊಟ್ಟಿಗೆ. ಅದರ ನಂತರ 1965 ಯುದ್ಧವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. 1971 ಯುದ್ಧವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. 1998 ನಾವು ಕಾರ್ಗಿಲ್ ಯುದ್ಧಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಆ ಒಂದು ಯುದ್ಧದ ಒಬ್ಬ ಹೀರೋ ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಮಧ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಚಾಲೆಂಜ್ಗಳನ್ನು 1962 ನಾವು ಚೀನಾದೊಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಹೋರಾಟವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಯಾಕೆ ಹೋರಾಟ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ದ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಅವರ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ. ದೇರ್ಫೋರ್ ಡಿಯರ್ ಲೇಡೀಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜೆಂಟಲ್ಮೆನ್, ಐ ಆಮ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ಲಿ ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ that we are all here in a very big number to celebrate the 68th anniversary celebrations of our constitution. ಈ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಆಚರಿಸ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ, ಸೆಲೆಬ್ರೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ, ಮತ್ತು ಆ ಸಂವಿಧಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ನಂಬಿಕೆಯನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಪಡಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ನಾವು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇರಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಸಂವಿಧಾನ ಹೋಯಿತು ಅಂತಂದರೆ ದೇಶದ ಆತ್ಮವೇ ಹೋಯಿತು ಅಂತ ಅರ್ಥ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಆ ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ನಮ್ಮ ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಒಂದು ಕರ್ತವ್ಯ. ಆ ಒಂದು ಸಂವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಹೇಗೆ ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಆಚರಿಸುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ. ಸೊ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಹಲವಾರು ಮಾನ್ಯರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇರಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅತಿಥಿಗಳಾಗಿ ಕರ್ನಲ್ MC ಅಯ್ಯಪ್ಪ, ಮರಾಠಾ ಲೈಟ್ ಇನ್ಫೆಂಟ್ರಿ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಆರ್ಮಿ ಅವರು ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರನ್ನು ನಾನು ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಸ್ವಾಗತಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಸೊ ಅದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಅಧ್ಯಕ್ಷತೆಯನ್ನು ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಕೆ ಭೈರಪ್ಪನವರು ವಹಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಕ್ಕೆ ವೃತ್ತಿಪೂರ್ವಕವಾಗಿ ಆಹ್ವಾನಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಅದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕುಲಸಚಿವರಾದಂಥ ಖಾನ್ ಅವರು, ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಖಾನ್ ಅವರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ನಾನು ಬರಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ತೇನೆ ಆಧಾರದಿಂದ. ಅಲ್ಲದೆ ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದೆಲ್ಲ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅಧ್ಯಾಪಕ ಮಿತ್ರರು, ಅದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬೋಧಕೇತರ ಸಿಬ್ಬಂದಿಗಳು, ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಗಳು ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನಾನು ಬಹಳ ಹೃತ್ಪೂರ್ವಕವಾಗಿ ಸ್ವಾಗತಿಸಲು ಬಯಸ್ತೇನೆ. ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಡೆಮೋಕ್ರೆಸಿಯನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ, ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕನ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಉಳಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ವಿಜಿಲೆಂಟ್ ಆಗಿರಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಒಂದು ವಿಜಿಲೆಂಟ್ ಆಗಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದು ನಿರಂತರವಾದಂತೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ, ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ನಾವು ಪ್ರತಿ ವರ್ಷ ಇಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಮಾಡುವಾಗ ಒಂದು ಭಾರತೀಯ ಸೇನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರೆ ನೌಕಾದಳ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಆರ್ಮಿ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಏರ್ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ಯನಿರ್ವಹಿಸತಕ್ಕಂಥ ನಿರ್ವಹಿಸಿ ನಿವೃತ್ತರಾದಂಥವ್ರನ್ನ ಕರಿತೇವೆ, ಅಥವಾ ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ಆರ್ಮಿ ಆಫೀಸರ್ಸ್ ಇಂದ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಕರಿತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಕರ್ನಲ್ MC ಅಯ್ಯಪ್ಪರಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರನ್ನು ನಮ್ಮ ಮಾಸ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಸರ್ಮನೀಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ರವಿಶಂಕರ್ ಅವರು ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ನಿಮಗೆ ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಗಣರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವದ ಶುಭಾಶಯಗಳನ್ನ ಹಾರೈಸ್ತಾ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಬರಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್.
ಎಂ ಲೋಕೇಶ್, ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟ್ರಾರ್ ಆಫ್ ಮ್ಯಾಂಗಲೋರ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ, ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಆನರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್, ಬಟ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಕಾಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಹಿಸ್ಟೋರಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಐ ಆನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರೆಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ನೇಷನ್ ಇನ್ ಟರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅವರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಅ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎನೇಬ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಅಸ್ ಟು ಲೊಕೇಟ್ ಅವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ವ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ, ವಿಚ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ need of this morning, because only then we derive the significance of the moment. And that significance will be enhanced by the presentation of flowers. I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. K. Bhairappa, to honor Colonel MC Ayyappa with a bouquet of flowers. These flowers today represent the fragrance of the nation. Our Registrar, Professor K.M. Lokesh, will welcome our Honorable Vice-Chancellor, the President of this morning's function, Professor Dr. K. Bhairappa. May I call upon the Dean of Commerce, Professor Muniraju, to kindly come over to present a bouquet of flowers to our Registrar, Professor K.M. Lokesh. May I request Dr. Jairaj Amin to kindly come over to the dais to present flowers to our Registrar Evaluation, Professor A.M. Khan.
Those flowers, ladies and gentlemen, embody the fragrance of the nation this morning and enable us and help us to celebrate this Republic Day. Friends, when you see the emblem of a bugle and cords and a pair of cross swords, then we think of the Maratha Light Infantry. The Maratha Light Infantry is one of the oldest regiments in the Indian Army. And when we think of the Maratha Light Infantry, then we cannot but help thinking of Colonel M.C. Iyappa. Colonel M.C. Iyappa is a native of Karnataka, is a native of Kodagu district of Karnataka. He started off in a small way in Kodagu doing his school education there. And then he completed his high school and college education in Mysore and Bengaluru. During his student days, he had actively participated in various NCC and sports activities, something that will bring cheer to the NCC contingent that has come here this morning from our university college and also the sports department of the university, which is always in the vanguard of organizing the Republic and Independence Day programs. While completing his BSc from Bangalore University, M.C. Iyappa was selected for a coaching scheme for talented athletes by the Sports Authority of India, Bengaluru. That is something that the sports department students will definitely celebrate. After graduation, M.C. Iyappa joined the Army through the CDSE entry route, and after undergoing 1 year of training from the Officers Training Academy, Chennai, he was commissioned as the second lieutenant to the 16th Battalion Maratha Light Infantry of the Indian Army in 1995. In the last 21 years, he has served in intense counter-insurgency environment of Jammu and Kashmir and the Northeast in Manipur and Nagaland. During the Kargil War, Colonel M.C. Iyappa was one who took part in operations along the line of control in the Uri sector of Jammu and Kashmir. He has also served as part of the United Nations peacekeeping mission in Ethiopia and Eritrea in 2001. And then he successfully commanded his battalion, the 16th Maratha Light Infantry, as its commanding officer for 3 years in Manipur and Gwalior. Recently, he was posted as the NCC Group Commander in Bangalore till August 2016 and was the Chief Training Officer for training the Karnataka and Goa Republic Day contingents, which stood second place in the Republic Day Parade in New Delhi. And that indeed is a moment, and that is a moment of pride for Karnataka and for all of us. And to cap it all, Colonel M.C. Iyappa is not just a talented sportsman and a brilliant military tactician, but also at the same time, he is an academician in the sense that he is now pursuing his 2-year postgraduate diploma in management in NSM Bangalore. So he combines all these various qualities and reaches out to us with that very rich and valorous traditions of the Maratha Light Infantry, one of the oldest regiments in the Indian Army, going back all the way to 1768. And from that time onwards, the courage and valor of the Maratha Light Infantry have been second to none. It is for that reason that we venerate Colonel M.C. Iyappa, and on that basis, we request him to speak to us this day. Sir.
Respected Vice Chancellor Professor K. Bhairappa, Registrar Professor K. M. Lokesh, and Registrar Professor Khan, I am very thankful firstly for the detailed introduction, more than kind to me. My dear students, we all know that Mangalore is emerging as one of the most important educational hub of the country today. Mangalore University, with its rich tradition of pursuing academic excellence and promoting young talent has contributed immensely towards this reputation. We all know that you are one of the best universities in Karnataka, and hopefully you will become the best in the country too. It's a matter of great honor and privilege for me today to be present here on the occasion of our Republic Day celebration 2017. Firstly, I understand it's an holiday, so I'll keep my speech brief and to the point. With my experience of interaction with the student community over the last 2 years, I have a fair idea of what the students would like to hear from an army officer. It is basically a little bit about our organization, that's the Indian Army, and most of them want to know a little bit about our operational experience. I'll be able to do justice to some extent to the first part, but second part, there are certain service restrictions. Since I am still serving, I may not be able to give out the details of any operations as such, but I'll try to make this small speech as interesting as possible. Considering the relevance of the day, already we have paid homage to our great freedom fighters who ensured our freedom in 1947, starting from Sri Mahatma Gandhi to Pandit Nehru, from Subhash Chandra Bose to Bhagat Singh. Each one of them in their own way contributed immensely towards our freedom struggle. Subsequently, leaders like Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and the other leaders helped in framing this brilliant constitution which has survived till now. And subsequently, I would like to today, on this great occasion, remember the sacrifices made by the number of soldiers of our armed forces. The point I am trying to make here is this freedom we enjoy each day, it comes at a price, at the cost of our soldiers' lives. Hence, we should value it and learn to cherish it. Talking about the army now, as I already mentioned, over the years, the armed forces, including the army, has played a significant role in safeguarding the hard-earned freedom of our country. It has successfully defended our country against many internal and external challenges over the years. When it comes to professionalism and commitment, we are second to none. It's not that I am from the army and I am trying to praise my own organization. This has been vindicated time and again by firstly our adversaries or enemies. Also in international forums where our army interacts with the professional armies of the other countries, there also this high standard of the Indian Army has been appreciated. For example, the United Nations, few of you would know, Indian Army is the biggest troop contributor to the UN for peacekeeping missions. We have earned an excellent name over there. Also, certain other international competitions, if you go on to Google and look into it, you may find the names. There is something called a Cambrian Patrol competition which happens every year in England. There is a special forces competition which happens between the special forces of various countries all over the world annually. In all these competitions, we usually come in the first three, which proves our efficiency. So, be it carrying out surgical strikes across the line of control, be it defending the nation on the icy heights of Siachen, which is also called the highest battlefield in the world. It's a height of 21,000 feet. be it fighting insurgencies of various types in Kashmir or Northeast, or let it be a small task of saving a child who has accidentally fallen into a borewell. Whenever the country has looked at the Indian Army, it has always delivered. The Army, while doing its duty, has also upheld the spirit of our constitution, which was just mentioned here, in the sense it, if we compare with our neighbors and what is their state today and what, where we are. A little bit of credit should go to the Army also for remaining highly apolitical. Whichever party is ruling, the Army has always supported the government of the day. It has remained more or less completely secular. You will be pleased to know that in many units where officers and men are there from all religions and regions, under one single building like this, there would be a temple, mosque, church and a gurudwara, all co-located, and each person would participate in the other's function. And thirdly, it has relatively remained incorruptible. I would not say we are completely free of this malaise. There are aberrations. We often keep seeing it on the media, and media usually highlights it because it becomes big news. But whenever such aberrations happen, we have internal process and system in place where strict action is taken in a very swift manner. I can give examples of Adarsh scam or Telka scam, which took place a few years back. In all these cases, wherever army people, after investigation, was found to be guilty, action was taken against them promptly, whereas their civilian counterparts, the cases are still going on. So, by and large, we all agree now that, hopefully, that the armed forces is a unique and most challenging profession in many ways. No other profession demands the supreme sacrifice of one's life so frequently. If you have been following the news, even yesterday we lost an officer there in Kashmir due to an avalanche. In fact, a recent study worldwide, it came out that one of the most stressful jobs in the world is a soldier's job. So this being the case, I'll come to the question we'll go into more deeply today. What motivates our soldiers to achieve the impossible? What motivates a person like Captain Batra, if you people remember Kargil, he was one of those heroes, who had just come down from an operation after capturing a peak, and he was again being sent back for another operation. He was asked for a reaction by Barkadat of NDTV, and he had replied with a smile on his face, that famous quote, "Ye dil mange mor," which he had taken from that Pepsi ad. What motivates people like our own Lance Naik Hanumanthappa, who about few months back fought with death for about 6 days while being buried under tons of snow in Siachen after coming under avalanche? So what makes these people do the impossible? There is no clear one single answer for this, and nor is there time for us to go deeply into it. But with my experience, what I could make out, what motivates these soldiers and officers, the first thing I would say is a firm belief in the firm faith in the cause. They sincerely feel that they are fighting and dying for a great national cause. This faith is reinforced to a large extent by the support and blessings of a billion plus Indians, including each one of you. As one famous military quote goes, a soldier does not attack his enemy in front because he hates him. He does it because he loves his country and countrymen behind him. So a soldier's basic needs are as it is catered for by the organization, by the government. By basic needs, I talk about food, clothing, accommodation, a decent pay. These things are catered for. But there are certain other human needs like security needs, social needs, self-esteem needs. This cannot be met only by the organization. This is where the role of each and every Indian citizen comes into play. To be more specific, the needs of soldier, this can be done by making him and his family secure and an important part of our society, by recognizing and respecting his sacrifices and achievements, and by responding positively to his genuine problems back home. By doing this, we'll contribute to the high morale of the Indian soldier. We have seen the positive result of this also during the famous Kargil war, when the entire nation, from our leaders, the ruling, the opposition, the media, the student body, or any component, all of us spoke in one voice and hence contributed towards a national aim. And with this joint effort, we could successfully win that war. Next aspect which motivates or gives the confidence to a soldier is the training aspect. We all know the training is very tough and hard in the army. We work with the premise that the more you sweat in peace time, the less you bleed in war. With this as the aim, from the day of joining, a soldier is trained to receive and execute orders without getting too much into the logic of these orders and decisions. This makes him a very lethal killing machine, which is very much required to win today's fast-paced, technology-driven, conventional or unconventional conflict. After all, it's not a sport where you can still lose the match and become a runners-up or second, third position. Because in war, there is only winner and loser. So, and every time he goes there, he has to win. The third point which motivates a soldier is the honor and traditions of his unit or regiment to which he belongs. This is actually a British tradition which has carried on, but it is still working in the sense some units have years of tradition and history behind them. The stories of extreme valor and courage of their ancestors are still motivating and inspiring the present generation. These small things matter a lot in the sense I have experienced it myself in my regiment. Every regiment has a war cry, and for us Marathas, it is war cry is the one which the soldiers shout when they at the last moment when they charge at the enemy. It's supposed to give them additional courage and strength. For Marathas, it is Bol Sri Chhatrapati Maharaj ki Jai. Whenever faced with a challenge and when this shout comes out from the troops, they get this additional strength and they perform double of what they are capable of. The last aspect today I will be touching upon and which has relevance to many of you is the leadership aspect, which has a major role in ensuring the success of any military operation. In the Indian Army, the leaders are always taught to lead from the front. This explains the high casualty rates among officers in all the major ops till date, because they are always there up in the front. You, most of you, I understand, are postgraduate students. You are, as it is, part of the elite group of students since you have made it to this level. And many of you may assume leadership roles in the near future. Few of you may still consider army as a career option. For those who fit into the requirement, as far as age qualification issues are concerned, and for those who have the right attitude and the aptitude, you will not regret this decision. Even today, the quality of life, the pay and perks, the job satisfaction, the numerous adventurous activities and hobbies you can pursue, and the overall job experience, all these are unmatched compared to many other professions. But for the vast majority of you who will opt for maybe research, civil services, or the noble profession of teaching, you all can still be a great asset to this country by excelling in whatever you do. There are few in my experience with NCC and in the various institutions. We do come across some students who are very keen to join the army, but unfortunately they don't get selected for various reasons. But it is not at all a thing to be demoralized about, because I keep giving examples of great persons who, if they had joined the army, it would have been a loss for the country, who, if they had been selected. Two important people who come to my mind are Sri Abdul Kalam and Mr. Amitabh Bachchan. Both had gone for that interview and they somehow didn't get selected. But today they are icons. We never had a better president, I feel, than Sri Abdul Kalam. And Amitabh Bachchan is still a superhero. So whether it's military, corporate, bureaucracy or any other profession, the basics of leadership is common. Certain tried and tested leadership principles of army, which was proved during Second World War, was incorporated into many other government departments in the corporate world, and they are being practiced today. So the basic issue, things like a sound professional knowledge, good communication skills, good decision making skills, good social skills, these are all a hallmark of a good leader. Coupled with this are some personality traits like honesty, integrity and character, which are required for a person to excel as a leader in any field. Just before concluding, I'd like to mention that, as I just mentioned, at time of independence, the powerful countries of those times, they didn't expect India to survive for long, considering the contradictions within the country, the diversity and such issues. But 7 decades down the line, we have proved most of those countries wrong. Today our democracy has thrived. We are the fastest growing economy. We are the biggest population of the youth population who are in the employable age, productive age. So we are destined to join these developed countries sooner than later. But at the same time, there are certain issues which are keeping us behind. Again, with my army experience, I can give out one thing which stands out. I have served in all the important metros of this country, and at the same time I have served in the remotest border areas of the country, the insurgency affected areas, and I also had a chance to serve for a brief time in Naxal affected central part of India. One of the things which will hold us back is the gap between the haves and the have-nots, of the rich and the poor. So you all have a role in bridging that gap, I feel. We can only be among the elite group of nations if each one of you succeed in your chosen profession. For that, you have to develop your talent, skills and intellect and contribute positively for the cause. Just before I finish, since I was associated with NCC till about few months back as a group commander in Bangalore and also as a cadet in my college days, I just wanted to share a good news which few of you would be already aware. Last year we came second in Delhi in the RDC. This year again we are in the first three. Yesterday itself I got a message, DDG has been called to Delhi. Hopefully it should be first or second this time too. And another proud, especially Mangalore has to be proud about is this time there are only two NCC contingents which march on the Rajpath today. They would be doing it right now. One is the girls contingent and one is the boys contingent. And the girls All India contingent is being led by your cadet from Madikeri, cadet Dechama. She is leading the national NCC cadet. And it's a privilege which has come, I think, after 19 years. Karnataka is doing it after 19 years. So anyway, all the best to you all. I thank you very much for having been given this opportunity. Thank you very much.
I'm sure we listened with rapt attention to Colonel M.C. Ayyappa, who presented before us standards of excellence and leadership and gave us this beautiful update at the end of his speech about the Karnataka contingent marching in New Delhi, the girls' contingent being led by one of our very own from Madikeri. Friends, it is time to celebrate that sense of pride that Colonel Ayyappa has instilled in all of us with another song of patriotism and integration by the students of the bachelor's and master's program of physical education at Mangalore University.
ತಾಳೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ತಾಯಿ ಪಾಪ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ ಜನ್ಮ ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ನಮ್ಮ ತಾಯಿ ಅನ್ನ ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಭೂಮಿ ತಾಯಿ ಮಾತು ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ತಾಯಿ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ ಪಾಪ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ ಓದಿದರು ಈಜಿದರು ಒಲೆಯ ಊದಬೇಕು ತಾಯಿ ನೆಲದ ಋಣ ತೀರಿಸಲೇಬೇಕು ತಾಯಿ ಭಾಷೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಕಲಿಬೇಕು ಕಾವೇರಿ ನೀರಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳೆ ಬೇಯಿಸಬೇಕು ಜನ್ಮ ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ನಮ್ಮ ತಾಯಿ ಅನ್ನ ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ನೀಡುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ತಾಯಿ ಪಾಪ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ ಪಾಪ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ
ಸಿಗುತ್ತಾಳೆ
ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ ಪಾಪ ಕಳೆಯುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಕಾವೇರಿ ತಾಯಿ.
ಗುಡ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಒನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್. ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಟು ವಿಶ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ ರಿಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಡೇ. ಡಿಗ್ನಿಟರೀಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಡೈಸ್, ಕರ್ನಲ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಎಂ ಸಿ ಅಯ್ಯಪ್ಪ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಮರಾಠಾ ಲೈಟ್ ಇನ್ಫೆಂಟ್ರಿ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಆರ್ಮಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ NCC Group Commander stationed in Bangalore, and my colleagues Professor K.M. Lokesh, the registrar of this university, and Professor A.M. Khan, registrar evaluation, dignitaries of the dais, my esteemed colleagues, faculty members from different departments, students and invitees, the family members of our faculty and the non-teaching staff, and also my proud NCC cadets and the sports persons from the physical education department. For a country, a huge country in terms of a rich country in terms of culture, population, history, this day is celebrated worldwide by all Indians. Living abroad in different countries and also Indians living within the nation, this 68th Republic Day, the day India declared as a nation with a very strong, a very sound, a very powerful constitution which cannot be shaken by anyone. As our registrar mentioned in his introductory remarks, we have established a very good tradition here in this university on two occasions, that is the Republic Day and the Independence Day, to invite the people serving in the defense or served in the defense, the heroes are brought here to show to our budding generation, the future generation, to share their experience. I was really spellbound when I heard the speech by Colonel Ayappa, who described his long journey to reach the level of colonel, and also I am sure that he will reach still higher positions. Still he is young, and you will be surprised, even his wife is a major in the army. So the family entirely dedicated to the nation, the national security. And he explained how the life of a soldier, how the life of a defense personnel serving at the borders, his own experience he narrated. And he told us that he served at the time of Kargil War in Uri area. You know very well how sensitive that area is today, a hotbed in Kashmir region. And we are able to have this kind of growth, pride, the progress in technology, the progress in higher education, the knowledge, power, economy, a strong economy, a stable economy, all that is possible only because of the strong constitution we have with us. And this is the day we have to remember all those who have sacrificed to get the freedom and also to save the nation from the external forces, both within and at the borders. You have seen the neighboring countries, as our registrar mentioned, Bangladesh or Pakistan, Nepal, Afghanistan, Burma, and even at times in Thailand. We see frequent disturbances, civilian riots, and so many other such major disturbances threatening the sovereignty of the country and the freedom of the citizens, all that. And it was rightly pointed out by Professor Lokesh, India did experience only for a short while during the emergency a kind of black mark in the history of Indian democracy, except that no other part of the Indian democracy, no other period experiences such a threat to the very existence of the civilians and their rights. All that has given a strength to the civilians and the citizens of our nation. As Colonel Ayappa mentioned, today's war is not just the war between the men, but it is also the war of the machines, the war of the technology involved. All of you know how the Americans fought the war in the Middle East. They didn't send too many people because they knew very well that people are not like the Indian soldiers. The American army is not like the Indian army as far as their performance is considered in the war front. In that way, India's great Indian army men are really great. And that's what Colonel Ayappa mentioned, that India always stands, Indian army stands one among the top three in the world always. And that is why Americans fought the war only through the machines. The reason, another reason was the way they lost the war in Vietnam. America lost. That was a terrible loss of men and machines. So it is in India, only in India we have both machines and men to safeguard our nation. Whatever we are today, whatever the lifestyle we have today, the richness and the entertainment, the enjoyment, whatever we have, it is all the sacrifice made by the soldiers at the borders in saving our lives. And a country like India, which has a very wide diversity, but still we have the unity and the secular nature. Colonel Ayappa mentioned that irrespective of the religion or the caste in the army, they are all one, they all have a single goal: save the country, protect the country from the enemies. This is the day to remember all such great persons to give us this kind of wonderful life, to give us this progress in economy and making the country strong and stable. It is all the services rendered by people like Colonel Ayappa and all other community of soldiers, great soldiers. And I don't want to take much time. As Professor Ravi Shankar Rao mentioned in his introduction while introducing me, he said, Mangalore University has so many innovative developments and things. Last Monday, there was a meeting of RUSA review committee meeting at the Higher Education Council in Bangalore. And all those vice chancellors, registrars, and the nodal officers were called for the review meeting. Myself and Professor P.S. Edapadithaya were there in that review meeting. And the executive secretary was time and again referring to Mangalore University, and he told the other vice chancellors, go and see the progress of the Mangalore University. And I'm not bluffing or exaggerating. Professor Edapadithaya is here. And he was the witness to those statements. And he must have told at least 5 times during that review meeting. And a few vice chancellors even commented, what is that great things they have done? And the answer was, better you go and see what is there, you will know. So I feel happy, and all that, it is not because of me. It is all just like our great soldiers who serve, who protect the nation at the borders. It is all because of my dear faculty members and my dear students who are very studious. And even Honorable Education, Higher Education Minister, exactly a week ago, last Thursday, mentioned here that Mangalore University is number one in terms of less issues, less financial mismanagement, and no issues to that matter. And in fact, Chief Minister, who was sitting next to me, was telling that the Higher Education Minister has briefed him already about the Mangalore University, the performance of the Mangalore University, and he was telling the culture of Mangalore is the reason for all that. The Chief Minister was telling the culture of Mangalorians, the coastal culture, which has a very strong background of this Exagana and the other folklores, all that probably is the main reason to have that kind of dedication in whatever the profession they are. That is why Mangalore University is number one in the country for sports. We stood number one in athletics, inter-university national championship. And even our H index, which gives the ranking to the university, it is pretty high, 56 now. It was just in 2013, it was 31. Almost doubled, and it is going to increase, and I have already come out with the plans how to increase the H index. And I am sure in the next 1 year, it will cross 60 and reach up to 65. That is my dream. So all that is possible because of the students, dedicated faculty, all that. So thank you very much. I wish you once again on this Republic Day. Have a great day. Thank you.
We have been listening to the presidential address by Dr. K. Bhairappa. Ladies and gentlemen, before we came into this auditorium this morning, we were witness to the, we paid tribute to the nation by hoisting the national flag. And at that time, you would have noticed a very smart NCC contingent doing the honors. That contingent from our university college in Mangalore is still here with us, and we would like to honor that NCC contingent by inviting senior NCC under officer CS Thyagavalli to kindly come over and receive a bouquet of flowers from Colonel MC Ayappa. This would certainly be a proud moment for her and for the contingent. The future of the nation is also here, friends. On behalf of everyone present here, may I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. K. Bhairappa, to felicitate and honor our chief guest, Colonel M.C. Ayappa, with a memento. That memento